G&D Media presents an unabridged recording of The Future of the Office by Peter Cappelli, narrated by Eric Burgher. Introduction. By 2005, Google had become the top choice of college graduates as the place to work. Its new office buildings were renowned for the employee perks: gourmet food for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, concierge service, bring your dog to work, spaces for napping, you name it. The fact that it had such terrific benefits had a purpose: to keep employees at the office. This was not only because they would be working more, but also because their interactions with each other sparked new ideas and innovations that were incredibly valuable to the company. Tech companies and a great many organizations saw this approach of getting people into the office and keeping them there as a best practice. Yet in May 2021, Google announced a sharp shift in the other direction. 20% of employees could work from home permanently, and another 20% could work remotely, tied to a series of Google locations elsewhere. The remaining 60% could work someplace other than their office 2 days a week, and for 4 weeks out of the year, they could work anywhere in the world. The takeaway? Get the workforce out of the office. After a year and a half of offices being shut down and employees working from home because of the COVID-19 pandemic, white-collar work all over the world is facing a fundamental inflection point for its future. Evidence and anecdotes say that many of those employees like working remotely, and that businesses survived and in some cases thrived. Unlike Google, many employers largely want to return to how things were before the pandemic, while employees want to maintain the flexibility they have grown to value. We now face a big question: what is the future of the office? Should we all go back to the physical space and the way things were? Should we continue to stay home? Or should we do something different? Forget the fascination with other topics that dominate when we talk about the future of work, such as what artificial intelligence might ultimately do to work, our obsession with trivial differences in the attitudes of generations, and other imagined issues. Working from home could change more about office work than anything in a century. It is upon us right now, and we have to choose fast. It sounds very sensible to go back to the office and pick up where we left off. We've been doing office work for hundreds of years, and we've figured out ways to manage problems and get things done there. We had a temporary break in the action that was a little longer than we predicted, but that will soon be over. Let's get back to work. On the other hand, it sounds equally sensible not to go back. Office employees generally liked working from home. Employers, remarkably, report that on balance, things work no worse and maybe even better with remote work. We've been at this for a year and a half. Why go back? Then there's the third option, something that incorporates office work and remote work and tries to make everyone happy. The wide variety of options here is what is known as a hybrid approach. But exactly what that means can vary dramatically from one organization to another. There was no choice during the COVID-19 pandemic. It forced a giant and unwanted experiment of having to work from home. It began as a speed bump, akin to a series of snow days for school children, then quickly turned into a longer-term event, as we might expect in recoveries from natural disasters. It then became a kind of new normal. In most cases, white-collar workers ended up working from home for well over a year, with no time to plan for how to do so. Now, there is time to think through what to do. Keeping things as they are means working from home almost entirely. As of the summer of 2021, most of the U.S. restrictions on staying home have been lifted. We can think more carefully about the path to take, employer by employer, but we have to choose. This decision has huge implications for individuals, for employers, and for society. There are advocates on all sides. Depending on whom you ask, it is a means of liberating people from office life, of reducing car commuting and pollution, or of destroying the commercial real estate market in center cities and making it impossible to get away from work. This could be the moment to redefine what work means for employees and how it fits into society. It could also be an opportunity to make a big and costly mistake. It could be the work-from-home experience during the pandemic was unique and will not translate to a more normal period. The problem is that it is not at all clear what we should do. Not everyone liked working from home, and there were a lot of other things going on besides working remotely that might not be replicated going forward. The experience where everyone had to be home is quite unlike the hybrid approaches most employers refer to now. There are potential arrangements where some people are in the office and others are not, where some people get to choose whether to be in the office or at home, and where some people are remote permanently. All have different and important implications. A cultural touchpoint at stake. The office has been a permanent fixture in white-collar work for centuries. It is not just the place where work gets done, but also the center of work-related intrigue, office politics, and public failures and successes. It is a source for literature, movies, and eponymous TV shows. Among other things, a remarkable 22% of all married couples have reported in recent years that they met and started dating at their offices. New York Magazine's May 2021 issue is an elegy to the office, documenting with personal anecdotes how intertwined its changes have been with our social lives and the experience of that city over the past 100 years. Given how much time we spend at work, getting rid of offices raises profound questions about social isolation if we retreat to our homes for work and for everything else. Then, there is the economic impact. Employers spend huge amounts of money on offices, in part showing off with corporate campuses, towering buildings, and individual offices designed to reflect and convey prestige on employees. The practice of counting ceiling tiles to see whose office was bigger has been a standard part of judging status. A lot of money went to basic amenities like bathrooms and ventilation systems, but also to designs that were supposed to stimulate performance. Breakout rooms to encourage informal meetings, interior designs to facilitate collaboration, and quiet rooms for individual tasks. A move away from offices would be a crisis for the $1.7 trillion office real estate industry, the $600 billion construction industry, and all the businesses and employees that serve office jobs. But office work also creates commuting, which has much less of a case for redeeming value as it costs time and money and pollutes. Two career couples and the demands of raising children create enormous tensions by keeping parents in the office longer and away from their children and their needs. Working from home has the possibility to end the former and solve the latter. We have very little time to think through these issues, but we must do so quickly. It is easy to forget, and many commentators have, that remote work in the form of telecommuting, as it was known then, was the hot topic throughout the 1990s. We have quite an extensive body of research evidence as to how things went, especially for employees. What is important about that context is that it is very much like the hybrid models we are considering again, and less like the all-in, everyone-is-home experience we will likely leave behind after the pandemic. That research, which I'll outline in Chapter 2, shows possible benefits for employers, but a worse picture for remote employees than we are imagining for the future. It is worth considering carefully why the interest in telecommuting faded so quickly, from being a dominant topic in the business press in 2000 to virtually disappearing by 2007. Silicon Valley companies such as Google created the new norm that extended the dominance of the office with new and huge investments in office space and related support systems designed not only to help performance, but to keep employees in the office. Office footprints and the investments in them got bigger and more entrenched. Now, it could be gone just like that. What's the reason for the shift? What do we make of the switcheroo by companies like Google, which, like other companies I'll talk about, is pushing employees out, yet also still planning to spend billions on a new campus in San Jose, California. Was the office a mistake all along? One interpretation is that the previous way of doing things was simply wrong. Not only was trying to keep everyone in the office longer a bad idea, but the whole idea of being in an office may have been a mistake. If it is true that not only are people happier, but offices are more effective if no one is in them, then it is a profound revocation of centuries of practice. All the effort in the past 100 years to design offices, to provide amenities to support employees, as well as all the research and practice about the importance of face-to-face interactions and communication, all of that is bested just by leaving people alone. That would be a remarkable conclusion. Maybe the pandemic was a unique situation for work, too. Another interpretation is that a lot of other things were going on during the pandemic that made it unique. Business results were far better than expected, in large part because of the unprecedented amount of federal money and support for businesses flowing through the economy. Many companies reported that the nature of the work they did during the pandemic was more nuts and bolts and less innovative than in normal times, when having everyone away from the office would have been a much bigger liability. The fact that employees were staring down a terrible situation, possibly being sick themselves, stuck at home, taking care of kids and family, and without a job or income, made the ability to work from home a blessing that demanded extra efforts to keep their organizations and jobs going. The most important other factor, which gets very little attention, is that almost all companies trusted their employees, perhaps because they had no choice, and could let up on the FaceTime model and micromanagement, focusing more on what employees were actually accomplishing. Smart employers asked their employees for help, and the ones that had been good to their employees got it. Can that be replicated going forward? Or do employees have options and employers know it? Finally, a third interpretation of the move away from the office that companies like Google have made might be that having had a taste of not being in the office all the time, employees have decided that they want to keep working from home. If Google wouldn't give it to them, someone else would. The genie is out of the bottle, at least for employees with opportunities. Those employees may end up paying a price for staying out of the office, but it will be hard to get them back to the office full-time, at least for a while. It may be better for employers to move to some remote work options before other employers offer them the alternative of staying home. Why I wrote this book. I have been studying the workplace for more than a generation, especially the practices employers use to manage employees. In the process, I have been documenting changes in those practices, how we hire, how we manage performance, and more. Every year over the past decade or so, there have been claims that some reasonably modest change will soon constitute the new normal. I have spent some time knocking those claims down. There is no doubt, though, that the shutdown of office work for a year and a half is a profound change, the likes of which the workplace has never seen. If someone had told us in March 2020 that we would be staying home and wouldn't return to the office for more than a year, it would have sounded impossible. How would the economy and society survive? It will take a long time before we truly understand how we adjusted and got work done. In the meantime, we have to decide what to do. What we have so far is not only conflicting advice, but conflicting evidence. We need a sober account of how things actually went during the pandemic, as good as we can get now, and we need to consider the reasonably extensive evidence we already had about remote working. That is what I try to do in this book. There are many options between all remote work and all on-site work. The choices this time really could constitute a new normal. Knowing how to choose is a pressing topic. In Chapter 1, I review what the experience of the pandemic has been. There are many caveats, the most important being that the information we have is still based mostly on opinion and extrapolation. But it is hard not to see the evidence we have is stunningly supportive of working from home, especially for employees, but even for employers. The most pressing question is how well the unique nationwide and company-wide experience of the pandemic would translate to the hybrid models under consideration.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.